worship today. It is wonderful to be able to gather in the house of our God as we come to worship and glorify Him, to lift His name up, and also to be nourished in His Word. It is a wonderful day and a weekend as we welcome Gia, who's the larger regional coordinator, right, for the Upper Midwest with Operation Christmas Child, and also Eve Dushimi, as he'll be sharing his testimony, as well as a children's message just a little bit into our service. So we welcome them today. As we come into worship, our call to worship comes from Psalm 150. The psalmist writes, "Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in the mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with harp and lyre. Praise Him with tambourine and dancing. Praise Him with the strings and flute. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." Praise the Lord. That is our desire this morning, is that we would come before our God to praise Him. Would you join me in prayer? O Lord, our God and Father, we give You thanks for this day and for this opportunity. That, Lord God, from week to week, You welcome us to gather in a time of rest. You've given us the freedom to worship, the freedom to turn to You and to assemble. And Lord God, we pray that as we hear music and as music is performed unto You, and as we sing our songs simply to glorify You, Lord God, we desire that Your name would be exalted. We pray, Lord God, that we might be edified in remembering the truths of Scripture that are proclaimed in these songs, and that they too would go out and be a comfort not only to us, but to all who hear them. All this we pray in Your Son's name. Amen. As we come before our God, let's stand to sing Jesus Messiah.
Sin.
We heard in those names, Emmanuel, that God is with us. Indeed, he is with us this morning, and he gives us this blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
Let's continue to praise our God as we sing Jesus, All for Jesus.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Well, at this time, I want to welcome up Eve Duchemie. I think I'm saying that right. Hopefully, close enough.
Close enough.
There you go. And we had the privilege of hearing from Eve and from Gia last night at the Area Leaders Workshop, and just an incredible testimony. I can say that I was blessed, and I think everyone there was blessed by the work that we heard of Operation Christmas Child doing, and hearing about Eve's testimony and how he received the shoebox gift himself. So I'll let him speak more about that, and welcome. Thank you.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Are the kids coming? The little
they
kids?
They can come.
The children? You guys gonna come hang out? Closer.
You're good.
All right. You can have a sip right here. Hi, everyone. You guys are looking nice and dapper. I wish I had the memo. I would have worn my suit, you know? How are you guys doing today? Good? Has anyone ever seen this shoebox before? Ever seen this anywhere? No. Can anyone tell me what it's all about? Operation Christmas Child. Do you know what it is that Operation Christmas Child does? Can anyone tell me? Yes? Yes, it gives shoeboxes to children all around the world and teaches them about God. So in Matthew, in Matthew 19, there's a story that was told where Jesus was hanging around and he was hanging out with people, and all of a sudden, this group brought these children that they wanted Jesus to pray for and lay his hands on them. And then all of a sudden, Jesus' disciples, you guys remember Jesus had disciples, right? Jesus' disciples were like, whoa, don't interrupt. We're busy over here, right? But then Jesus was like, guys, hold up. Let these children come to me because the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. So what does that mean? That means that Jesus was like, look, all of the kids around the world also need to hear the message that I have to say, not just grown-ups, but kids such as yourselves. So all across this world are many kids who have never heard the name of Jesus. They have never heard of God. And what Operation Christmas Child does is they pack these shoebox gifts and they fill them with what? Can you tell me what goes in here? Toys? No. Yes. School supplies and clothes and hygiene items and fun things and you know, toy cars, soccer balls. But they fill them with all these things, not because of the stuff that's in here that matters, but the message that comes with the stuff. And that message is what? That Jesus loves them, and he wants to be their savior as the kids, just as he is for the adults. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that cool? Don't you want all the kids around the world to hear about Jesus just like you do? Yeah? So this is an amazing way to demonstrate God's love to those children in the same way that God's love is shown to you guys every day. So how many of you guys think you're going to pack a shoebox this year? We got a little work to do over here, but we'll get there. You're the pastor's kid, so you have no choice. Yeah, so I am excited to hear that you're the pastor's kid, so you're going to be packing. And I met Mom yesterday and the rest of the family, and I know you guys are going to be packing. So thank you for joining me, and you guys can go back to your seats. Thank you. Look at them go. Now to the adults. You guys want to come up and huddle over here as well, or how are we doing this? I am just so excited to be here this morning with all of you. It has been my honor to get back on the road this week, and I want to introduce someone special this morning. Gia Moser, will you just wave your hand? Gia is the regional director for Operation Christmas Child, and she oversees the upper Midwest states, and that includes Illinois, Wisconsin, Minnesota, the Dakotas, what am I missing? And Iowa. Isn't that incredible? All of that. So if you ever have any questions about the ministry of Operation Christmas Child, what we do, and how you can get involved, Gia will be here at the end, and so will I. But my name is Eve Dushime. Pretty close, right? It was pretty close. You had it. And I have had the privilege of serving as a spokesperson for Samaritan's Purse in the ministry of Operation Christmas Child for the last 6 years of my life. And that is because when I was 11 years old, I received one of these shoebox gifts. How many of you guys have seen this before? You've seen, okay, how many of you guys have packed a shoebox in the past? Okay, how many of you guys are planning on packing this year? We got some work to do over there. But we'll get there. Oh, we got one. We'll get there. So I received a shoebox gift when I was 11 years old, living in the country called Togo in West Africa. Anyone ever heard of Togo? I think I brought a map here for those of us that are geographically challenged. You're welcome. Togo is that green country there at the top left of your screen. But that's not where I live now. I currently live in a tiny little place called Buffalo, New York. You guys ever heard of it? Yeah. My family resettled there as refugees through a refugee resettlement program with the United Nations in 2008. And the way it works is, you know, families and in refugee camps will apply for resettlement. And it's not a very common program because only 2-3% of the people that apply ever get in. So we applied in 2001 and kind of figured we fell in the pile that wasn't accepted because 7 years went by. And in 2008, they called us on a Friday and they were like, hey, remember that thing you filed for 7 years ago? Well, you've been approved and you leave in 8 days and you're moving to a place called Buffalo, New York. Now, they didn't tell us what was waiting for us in Buffalo, New York. Because believe if they had, well, we might have chosen a place, you know, further south, if you know what I mean. I know you guys understand snow and the weather, but a few years back, Buffalo had 7 feet of snow. I wish I was exaggerating. Now, this is really interesting for a kid who grew up in West Africa in Togo there, where it's 80, 90 degrees every single day. But, you know, Togo is where I received my shoebox gift, but that's not where I'm originally from. My family is originally from the country of Rwanda. Anyone ever heard of Rwanda? What's the first thing that comes to mind when you think of Rwanda? Genocide. Yeah. Rwanda is that red country there in the heart of Africa on that map. And in case you don't remember, in 1994, Rwanda went through one of the worst atrocities to have ever befallen the history of humanity, the Rwandan genocide. And this was a conflict sparked by a political struggle between two people groups. And I need to tell you about it because it's at the heart of who I am, who I became, how I was raised. Two ethnic groups, Hutus and Tutsis, for generations they couldn't get along. But they always find a way to make it work. But in 1994, those tensions erupted into what came to be known as the genocide, when within the first 100 days, 1 million people were killed. 1 million people. I don't know if you can tell, but that's a tiny little place. There was about 5 million people in the entire population. And in the span of 100 days, that's just over 3 months, 1 million people gone. And what makes this thing worse is the fact that it wasn't a foreign country that invaded us and started killing our people to the point where we would have a common enemy to unite against. It was our very own people killing one another, killing people for the crime of being born in an ethnic group they didn't choose to be born into. That's what people lost their lives over. Now, I'm sharing this with you because among that million were my family members. I've never gotten the chance to meet my uncles, my cousins, my grandmothers, my grandfathers, because they were killed for the crime of being born in an ethnic group they didn't choose to be born into. I've only ever met my mom's little sister in my extended family. Everyone else gone. You know, I was born in that blue country there that you see in the heart of Africa when my family had to leave. I was born a month later. My mom left the country when she was 8 months pregnant with me, and they moved into a refugee camp in the Congo, which is where I was born, and we lived in Kenya, that yellow country as well. But along the way, I started asking questions. You know, how is it that all these families have other people? You know, that beyond mom, dad, and brother and sister, where are these people coming from? Who are they? How are they related? And where are my people? And my family began to explain to us as we got older what had happened. And It made no sense to me. How could humanity take the lives of others based on a choice they never had? It made no sense. So I went out of my way to find answers. And in my quest for answers, I didn't find any. None that were good enough. And that left me broken. It left me wrecked and brokenhearted and frustrated and angry. But more than that, it left me with a resentment for running people and a hatred for humanity as a whole. I hated people. I hated the world because of what they had put us through. And that hatred consumed every bit of who I was. And I saw no way out, which is really interesting because I grew up in a Christian home. My dad's a pastor, you know. And growing up, he would tell us, look, Eve, you got to love your neighbors as yourself. And I would tell him, Dad, you're the pastor here. That's your thing. I don't know how you can expect me to love the very people that killed your mom and your dad. The hatred in my heart consumed every bit of who I was, and I saw no way out. You know, it's not easy growing up with that kind of burden on your shoulders and in your heart as a kid. I was deeply in need of something to free me from that. And, you know, despite the fact that I saw no way out, God made a way. And he used someone just like you to get me there through the gift of a simple shoebox gift. Now, some of you are thinking, Eve, that sounds crazy. Okay, I thought these were just Christmas gifts. How could they possibly have such a profound effect on your life? Well, let me tell you how. The day I received my shoebox gift, I remember standing out there in the courtyard at the church. It was 80, 90 degrees, and we were in line, ready to receive shoeboxes. And of course, as the pastor's kids, we had to go to the back of the line because that's the way it worked. And I was all anxious, you know, about, am I going to get mine? You know, what's going to happen? Sure enough, I was handed one. And when I opened up that shoebox, at the very top, there was a sticky note. You guys know what a sticky note is, right? And on that sticky note were the words, God loves you, Jesus loves you, I love you. Now, I had heard the first two lines before. I knew those things to be true in some way, shape, or form. But here I was, faced with an I love you from a member of that very humanity that I had grown to despise and sworn to despise for the rest of my life. And they were telling me that, look, Eve, despite your hatred for me, I love you anyway. And here is proof of my love for you in the form of the one and only gift you've ever received, and it's filled with the very things that you desperately need to go to school and hygiene items and all these wonderful things. Let me tell you, that sticky note wrecked me. Okay, it shook my world to the core because it challenged every single previously held beliefs that I had in my heart that humanity was doomed and didn't deserve my love and kindness, because here was someone proving to me otherwise. And all of that didn't happen, you know, instantly. But God began to use that sticky note in my life to start a work of healing, where he started to rid me of all that anger, of all that hatred, of all that pain, simply by reminding me that if an ordinary man or woman out there in the world could demonstrate this kind of love towards me, then how much greater was his love for me, for us be? God met me exactly where I was, and he used a stupid sticky note to do that. I have never been the same. My life was eternally changed 15 years ago now. And that shoebox that I received 15 years ago continues to chase me today, continues to change my life today. And the amazing thing, the great news is, I'm not the only one. There are over 178 million children all across this world who have been impacted directly as a result of Operation Christmas Child and your filling of these shoeboxes. And I can't speak for all of them individually, but I certainly can speak for myself, and I can speak for my community. You know, in the place where we lived in Togo, by the way, you guys ever heard of Togo till today? You've heard of Togo? No? Thank you for your honesty. Togo is a tiny little country in West Africa, 7-8 million people in its entire population. They speak French along with, you know, dozens of other native tongues, and we lived there for about 10 years. But how many of you guys knew Togo is one of the poorest countries in the world? Did you know that? And when I say poor, I'm not talking America poor, okay? I'm talking a different kind of poor. How many of you guys know what I'm talking about? Some of you guys don't look convinced. We are so wealthy in this country. We are so blessed in this country, it's insane. And some of you guys don't look convinced either. Maybe it's the mask. But let me ask you this. By a show of hand, and this is a very personal question, so just bear with me. Don't throw any tomatoes or anything like that at me. How many of you guys took a shower this week? I'm not even going to ask today because that's way too personal. How many of you guys took a shower? Just raise your hand. Keep those hands up there. Everybody, look around. Look around. You can see who has good hygiene and who doesn't. But everyone thankfully does. But you ever think about the fact that when you're in the shower and you're cleaning dirt off of your bodies, you're washing dirt off of your bodies with the very water that 700 million people across the world that we know of are in desperate need of to drink? You ever think about that? And I'm not even going to talk about how we use it to water our lawns or flush our toilets. We are so wealthy in this country, it's insane. Togo is a different kind of poor. I grew up with kids who couldn't go to school simply because they couldn't afford a pack of pencils. And I know that sounds crazy because we can go to the Dollar Tree, you guys have the Dollar Tree, and buy a pack of pencils for $1 and be able to use it for the rest of the year. But here's the thing, maybe some of you guys with younger kids, maybe with grandkids, you could probably go home, go in your living rooms, go digging in your couch cushions and find enough school supplies to supply an entire school. How many of you guys know what I'm talking about? We are so wealthy in this country, it's insane. You know, it's insane. I grew up with kids who couldn't go to school because they didn't have that. And if it sounds crazy to believe, simply because, you know, a pack of pencils is $1. $1, one American dollar is the equivalent of 500 of their currency. So it's simply out of reach. And this is where I grew up, and not only did Togo struggle with that kind of physical poverty, but they struggled with a spiritual kind as well. And that had to do with witch doctors and witchcraft and voodoo and black magic. Have you ever heard of voodoo, witchcraft? This stuff is real, by the way, and the reason why it's real is because the devil is real, okay? And these witch doctors were these leaders in the communities that had persecuted the folks and told them never to set foot in a church. Never to talk to the Christians, that the Christians were the enemy, which made it really interesting because my dad's a pastor. And he was trying his best to minister to the folks in Togo, but for years it didn't work. No one wanted to talk to him because they were too afraid of what the witch doctors might do to them if they were seen talking to the pastor. Well, that all changed in the year 2005 when somebody called Operation Christmas Child was like, yo, we have these 300 shoeboxes. They're filled with school supplies, hygiene items, toys, all this stuff, and they're completely free. Would you like them? Now, I wasn't there for that conversation, but I imagine my father's response was, duh. You know, of course we would like them. And look, we didn't have cell phones back in the day, but the word spread fast. People heard quickly that the church, the local church, had their hands on 300 shoeboxes. Each and every single one of them had school supplies. And they were conflicted. Because look, we have an opportunity to send our kids to school for the first time ever. But the witch doctors told us not to go to the church. A lot of families started thinking, look, do we continue to cower to the threat of these witch doctors? Or do we become brave for a day and defy them and go get school supplies so we can send our kids to school? I'm willing to guess that every parent in this room would have chosen their kids because that's exactly what these families did. And they all poured into this church, families of people that had sworn never to set foot in a church, families of witch doctors showed up to the church to get a shoebox gift. But whenever they got there, they were met with an even greater gift, and that is the gift of God, of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, my dad looked into this crowd that had gathered in our church courtyard, and he was like, man, we are never going to get these people back here again. In front of us is a captive audience, so before we give them shoeboxes, how about we preach the gospel? You know, and that's exactly what he did. And that's the kind of evangelism that Operation Christmas Child is making possible all across this world. Families that had never heard the name of Jesus were able to hear the gospel for the first time and hear about another powerful but merciful and loving God who could free them from the bondage of all the witch doctors in their communities. In fact, in my very region, there was a powerful witch doctor, a man who had threatened my dad for so many years because of, you know, the nature of my father's word, threatened to kill us and all this other stuff. And one day we were hanging out at our house, and I remember looking out the window, and what do I see in the distance? That very witch doctor coming straight at us. Now, our house was the only one in the corner of this village, so I figured he was coming, you know, to our house, especially because he was dragging these heavy bags alongside him, and I figured those are the weapons he's here to kill us. So I ran to Mom and Dad, and I was like, Mom and Dad, he's coming. You know, and they rushed us into our house, and they shut the door, and we sat there in silence, hoping he would think there was no one home and leave. But then we heard. I've been through a lot in my life, but I've never been that afraid, because death was literally at my doorstep. And this man just kept on knocking and knocking and knocking. Eventually, my dad got up and went to get the door, crazy man that he is. But it was the only exit. We had to come out eventually. And when those doors swung open, I heard words that I'll never forget for as long as I live. This witch doctor said, Pastor Jean-Baptiste, that's my father's name. He said, I have come here today because I have realized that your God is so much stronger than my God, and I am here to give my life to your Jesus. That wasn't the reaction in that room. It was dead silent. And in the back of my head, I'm thinking, come again. I have come here today because I have realized that your God is so much stronger than my God, and I am here to give my life. In fact, I have a picture of that moment here. In the middle, there is that witch doctor. This is that very night in my courtyard at home, and there is my dad on the left-hand side there, leading this man in prayer, and that's his wife and his two younger kids, and there they are. This man is surrendering his life to our Jesus. Now, I don't know if you can tell, but there's a bunch of people in the background. Now, those people did not live there, but they had quickly heard that the lead witch doctor was hanging out with the very family that he had forbidden everybody else from hanging out with, and they all came to figure out what was going on. And guess what that turned into? An outreach event. And I want us to jump to this next photo here. Here's a man who had never bowed down to anyone or anything other than the powers that he served, and he's on his knees surrendering his life to Christ. But I want you to focus on the bottom left corner here. Those things you see on the ground, there was plenty more to the side. Those were his witchcraft tools that he had dragged along with him for miles, and he brought them out to say, he was like, Pastor Jean-Baptiste, I want you to light these things on fire. I want you to burn them. I want this village and villages across the way to know that on this day, I have decided to follow your Jesus. Now, I don't know if you're tracking with me or you're grasping the grandeur of this, but this would be the equivalent of all of us taking up our Bibles, going in the parking lot and lighting them on fire. There is no turning back. This man had decided to follow Christ as a result of what? A distribution that had happened a few months prior of what? Shoebox gifts. And I know I'm supposed to be sharing my story, and I'm talking about some witch doctor, but this man's story needs to be told. Because in the weeks that followed, he kept going into his regular witch doctor meetings, and he wasn't going there to practice his regular witchcraft. And he was the leader of the witch doctors in the region. But he kept going into those meetings to preach. He was going there to share the gospel with his fellow witch doctors. Now, he was the boss, so they had to sit there and listen to him. Almost overnight, this guy had become best friends with my dad. It was weird for me, because we would see him, you know, a pastor and a witch doctor. It's not a natural sight by any sense of the term. And they would go into people's houses and minister together. And he would drop by our house unannounced all the time. It was so weird, because at first glance you think, oh, but then you remember he's on our side now. But, you know, he would drop by our house all the time, usually around dinner time. We had figured that one out. I think he liked my mother's cooking. One day he came to our house and he was like, Pastor Jean-Baptiste, I've been reading this Bible you've been giving me, and I've been reading up on something called baptism. Can you tell me more about that? And my dad told him, you know, it's a public declaration of faith. It's a symbolic dying to our old self and a renewal and a rebirth in Christ Jesus. And the man was like, well, am I eligible? And dad's like, of course you're eligible, man. So they set up a time and a date to go to the local river to baptize this one man. And whenever they got there, this happened. These people that you see on the screen are people a witch doctor had witnessed to, led to Christ, and invited to be baptized alongside him. All of these people's lives being changed, all of their stories can be tracked back to a place like this one, where 300 shoeboxes were packed, made their way to the country of Togo. They were distributed. A witch doctor came to know Christ and then led all these other people to him. That is the multiplication we're talking about. That is the discipleship Operation Christmas Child is all about. None of these people ever got shoeboxes. But I don't know if you can tell how far back that line goes. It goes on and on and on. And if we jump to this next photo here, my dad's in the water. There he is on the right. He's expecting to baptize one guy, and all these people are showing up. Let's go back to that picture. This gentleman that you see here, the second line, his name is Mauko. He's not a kid anymore. He's a grown-up now. And he is the deacon of the church that still stands today, that was built as a result of that very baptism that day. All of those people went and formed a church. People all across the world are being changed, and they're being changed. Their lives are being impacted as a direct result of your shopping, you know, and your packing, and you're reaching out to friends and families all over. A simple shoebox gift. And you know, when I was talking about how the shoebox is still chasing me today, there was an item I had in my box, and I'm out of time here, but can I show them this? This was in my box, you know, those 15 years ago, at the very bottom. I still have it with me. Can anyone tell me what this is? Can anyone tell me where I lived? I had no clue what this thing was, okay? I was like, man, this person had packed, you know, school supplies. I had a red toy car in there, all this fun stuff, and then this. What are you doing, you know? I didn't know what it was, so I went to the other kids and I tried to trade it for something better. All of them laughed in my face, so I was stuck with it. And if you've ever packed those scarves in your box, just don't feel guilty yet. Bear with me. I hung on to it for a very long time. It hung on my wall at the house, and sometimes I would use it as a bandage. You know, if I ever got hurt playing soccer, we did that a lot. I didn't need it for my neck, so I figured I'd use it elsewhere. But I hung on to it. Fast forward 3 years later, my family is resettled where? Buffalo, New York. And I remember stepping off that plane on October 29, 2008, and being hit by that cold, brisk air, okay, something we had not, our skin, we didn't have AC, we didn't have a fridge. Our skins had literally never felt air that cold before, and all of us just kind of turned and we looked at Dad, and we're like, Dad, you messed up. Where have you brought us? What is this nonsense? But you know what? As we were walking towards the terminal, something clicked in my head. I had packed something in my backpack nobody else had, so I gently proceeded to pull it out, and with a whole lot of sass, I wrapped it around my neck. I looked at my brothers, and I was like, that's right, who's laughing now? I was on top of the world, you know. It only lasted 2 minutes, because when we got in the terminal, there was a welcoming committee with coats and scarves and hats and all this stuff. But, you know, looking back, the scarf is a powerful reminder of God's sovereignty in my life. The fact that he knew my past, the things that I had struggled with as a kid, the hatred that I harbored in my heart for humanity, and he did something about it with a sticky note. Not only did he know my past, but in our present, as my father was struggling to minister to witch doctors and witchcraft followers, he knew our present. And then he invited people like yourselves to pack 300 shoeboxes so those barriers would be broken and the gospel would be preached. And in the same way, he knew my past, my present. He knew my future. And this is a powerful reminder of that. This is the most valuable thing I own today. And I believe that out there somewhere in the world is a kid just holding on to a pencil sharpener you might have packed in your box 5 years ago. Or something that has brought meaning and value to their lives. And I wanted to take a moment today, Pastor Dan, to express my sincerest gratitude to each and every single one of you. Because the person that sent me that box and that sticky note, they never signed the note. I don't know who they are, you know? And until I find out who they are, I'm going to thank everybody. Which reminds me, if you pack a shoebox and you include a note, please, for the love of everything that is holy, sign the note so we can find you someday. But you are making it possible for millions of children to know Christ, and that is no small feat. So may God bless you for who you are, and thank you very much. God bless you.
I don't know how I follow that up. We knew this last night, but it's a way better speaker than I am. So, but we do want to pray for Eve and for Operation Christmas Child, and thank you so much for them coming. Billy Joe, before we pray, Billy Joe shared some really cool details. First of all, our church was in the top three, or is in the top three churches of Western Wisconsin churches as far as the number of shoeboxes packed. So that's a pretty incredible thing. Again, people think we're this huge church, and it's like, nope. A lot of things happening. And to think about that, I think last year, 386 shoeboxes. And so we're talking about, you know, a whole distribution to a community. More than that can come from our church. But last year, Billy Joe did purchase, you can purchase Follow Your Shoebox labels. And she tracked our boxes over to Namibia, which is in southern Africa. And we don't know for sure if the boxes went to this community or this people group, but we heard, or she found some information about boxes that went to the Himba people. And the Himba people are an unreached people group who in the last year dedicated their very first church ever. So again, we don't know if our boxes went there, some of them, all of them, none of them, but the boxes are going to places like that, to unreached people groups. And as Eve just shared, it all starts with kids getting these boxes, taking it home, sharing it with their families and their friends. And similar to his story, people have abandoned the witch doctors and are seeking to worship God alone and to pray to him alone. And that is an incredible thing. If you take nothing else away, which I don't know how you aren't going to take anything else away, but if you take nothing else away this morning, be assured that the testimony that we heard last night was incredibly powerful. That this isn't just giving away stuff. This isn't just trying to put colorful, fun little toys that we don't want our kids to have, but maybe some poor kids around the world will have. This is the gospel. Going out to the ends of the earth. That is their mission right now, to go to the ends of the earth. They shared about how they're currently working on 1,000 islands in the Pacific of unreached people groups. And to give you a scale of the work that they're doing, you know, we said 386 is what we packed last year. The whole Midwest is aiming for 524,000, just the upper Midwest, among millions in our country, and I think you said six other countries are involved in this work. So we have a very small part, and yet we hear kingdom benefits happening. And so that's an incredible thing. Let's go to our God in prayer this morning. O Lord, the God of this world, the God of all gods, the only true God, Lord God, how thankful we are that as we gather here as a body of believers in Baldwin, Wisconsin, Lord, this town of just around 4,000 people, Lord God, that we get to see connections this morning to Togo and to Namibia and to places in the Pacific. Lord God, for us who have been here in this area for over 120 years, that we get to see places, and we get to be a part of the gospel being shared for the very first time in the present. Lord God, that is not a credit to us, but it is a credit to you. It is a credit to the call that you have placed in our lives, the call that you have placed on our hearts. And so, Lord, we give you all the praise and all the glory for the work that is being done through Operation Christmas Child. Lord God, we give you thanks this morning for the opportunity to hear again from Eve and for just, Lord God, the way that you've worked in his life. Lord God, what an incredible testimony of how often we talk about just how sin wrecks us and how sin causes death and it causes hatred. And yet, Lord God, that hatred is not something that you are not able to overcome. And Lord God, so we give testimony, we give thanks to you for the witness that he has shared today, for bringing him to yourself. And Lord God, we pray that you continue to be with him, that you'd work mightily in Eve as he shares in just a small part of what he does as a national spokesperson. Lord God, we give you thanks too for Operation Christmas Child as a ministry and for the work that Samaritan's Purse is involved in here and around the world. Lord God, we pray today for their national leadership, for the decisions that need to be made and the guidance that need to be given in difficult years like this. But Lord God, too, we thank you for regional staff. We thank you for volunteers around the world that are willing to connect with them and to share the gospel. Lord God, to take up the discipleship program that these shoebox recipients, these young kids, have the opportunity to receive when they receive that gift. Lord God, we pray that you continue to work through this ministry for your kingdom. And Lord God, would you continue to bless us here in the ministry that Billy Joe and Dee lead us in. Lord God, we give you thanks for this day and for, Lord, the power of redemption, the power of healing, the power of reconciliation that you alone can work. Lord God, we know that in the midst of our trouble, in the midst of our trials in this life, that there is nothing that you cannot be present with us through. So Lord God, we lift up to you today those who are struggling with illnesses, those who are shut into their homes and staying isolated due to the COVID-19. Lord God, we lift up to you those who are awaiting frustratingly, patiently for surgeries. Lord God, as we think of Kelly again this morning and ask that she'd be present in her situation, Lord God, that you would allow the process of reviewing her case to go through so that she can have surgery. Lord God, we lift up to you Al as he receives treatment for his cancer. We lift up to you Wes as he continues to recover from his stroke and from the effects of the COVID several months ago still. And Lord God, in all of this, we are reminded that there are so many other ailments. There are so many other people going through struggles that are not shared. Lord God, it's easy to say, well, there's someone worse off than me. There's someone who has something far more painful, far more debilitating than what I have. And yet, Lord God, you hear us. And we are reminded not just to ask for the freedom from symptoms, but Lord God, you call us to go to the root of things. Lord God, that you would root out, that you would take away that which hinders our lives. Lord God, we pray that you would bring healing unto us. We pray, too, for healing in this world. Lord God, as we continue to see division amongst peoples, as we don't have to look even back to the 90s to see division between different clans in different places around the world that have brought great harm to one another. Lord God, we pray for peace that passes all understanding and the peace that your Son, Jesus, alone can provide. And we ask, oh God, that he would return soon. Lord God, would you be with us today? Would you continue to send your Spirit in this place and in the message that is to be shared? Lord God, give us what we stand in need of each and every day. All this we pray in your Son's name. Amen. I didn't get my sermon done until last night at 10:30, which is not abnormal, just so you know. But it was good that I was at the workshop and hearing Eve, and I was like, all right, yep, we're going to keep shortening this. We're going to keep cutting stuff out, chopping the sermon down. So it's still a little bit lengthy, but it's not at my normal length. And I do want to preach it because this is the last week that I'm going to preach on Acts before we take a one-week break, and then we'll start up the road to the end of Acts. And so this morning, I invite you to look in your order of worship or turn in a Bible to Acts 21, Acts 21, 1 to 16. Paul is going to get to the doorstep of Jerusalem today. If we could go back one slide. I didn't tell Eve that I like maps, but this is pretty cool. He shared the map just to the south, and this is my map. So we're going to hear everything in the northwest corner, all in verse 1. That Paul's going to go from Miletus to Kos to Rhodes to Patara, and then he's going to head over in the direction of Phoenicia. He's going to head over here to the southeast area, and this is the last time that he's going to head east. The last time in his life that he's going to travel this far over, and again, it's because we're going to get stuck in Jerusalem and in Caesarea in the next coming chapters. But then things are going to slow down in our passage. Entire Paul's going to spend a week. He's going to spend a quick one day in Ptolemais, and then he's going to spend a number of days in Caesarea before he starts making his way to Jerusalem. And that is where our passage will end. So let's hear the word of the Lord this morning. After we had torn ourselves away from them, from the Ephesian elders, we put out to sea and sailed straight to Kos. The next day we went to Rhodes, and from there to Patara. We found a ship crossing over to Phoenicia, and so we went on board and set sail. After sighting Cyprus and passing to the south of it, we sailed on to Syria. We landed at Tyre, where our ship was to unload its cargo. Finding the disciples there, we stayed with them 7 days. Through the Spirit, they urged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. But when our time was up, we left and continued on our way. All the disciples and their wives and children accompanied us out of the city, and there on the beach we knelt to pray. After saying goodbye to each other, we went aboard the ship, and they returned home. We continued our voyage from Tyre and landed at Ptolemais, where we greeted the brothers and stayed with them for a day. Leaving the next day, we reached Caesarea and stayed at the house of Philip the Evangelist, one of the seven. He had 4 unmarried daughters who prophesied. After we had been there a number of days, a prophet named Agabus, we've heard him before, Agabus came down from Judea. Coming over to us, he took Paul's belt, he tied his own hands and feet with it, and he said, "The Holy Spirit says, in this way, the Jews will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles." When we heard this, we and the people there pleaded with Paul not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, "Why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." When he would not be dissuaded, we gave up. And he said, "The Lord's will be done." After this, we got ready and we went up to Jerusalem. Some of the disciples from Caesarea accompanied us and brought us to the home of Manassen, where we were to stay. He was a man from Cyprus and one of the early disciples. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I think you know that I'm not a reckless person. I have no desire to go skydiving. I don't desire to ride a motorcycle. I've rappelled several times, and I even knew, at least in the past, how to safely set up a rappel at the top of a cliff. But to actually take those steps backwards, to go over the cliff, to walk off the side of a really tall wall, there is no rational sense to that. And yet you know me, unlike Eve, that I'm the one who goes and drives his truck out on the ice just to go fishing. So recklessness has a different meaning to different people. And yet recklessness always entails something that is legitimately dangerous. And yet there are dangerous situations that aren't looked upon as reckless, but are looked at as selfless. This week, as we remembered September 11, 2001, I was reminded of the accounts of some of those first responders who went into the World Trade Center towers. Maybe like many of you, I have etched in my mind those pictures and those videos of people running away from the dust and the debris and the devastation. I'll never forget that. And yet the first responders ran toward it. And some of them, of course, ran into the towers multiple times to rescue people, to guide them out to safety. And in the course of saving their lives, it cost them hundreds of theirs. And yet you wouldn't say, well, they were reckless. No, they were selfless. And maybe even more so, we say that when innocent people put themselves in harm's way, when they do something to protect others, to save others, even if it means they're going to die, that it was also selfless, or it was even heroic. And I think all of that shows the value that many people, including us, place on life and on life continuing. If we compare how things are here today to much of history, to different parts of the world, people's life expectancy is incredibly high. Again, not all times. If you go back to Genesis, we find people living hundreds of years. But today we do have quite a high life expectancy. And particularly if we're young and we're healthy, we say, well, I want to hold death off as long as possible. I don't want it to come too soon because there's things that I want to do. There's things that I want to see. My kids, I want to celebrate with them and their grandkids, everything that I can. And yet I said it at Myra Van Zomeren's funeral several weeks ago now, that one of the most wonderful things for me as a pastor to hear, and usually it's to hear it from older Christians, is that they're ready to die. They're ready to go. In the certainty of their faith, they know that whenever that day comes, it's fine with them. And some of them are longing for that day. They want that day to come sooner. And so this morning, as we look at this passage, I want us to focus in on this whole idea of being ready to die. We're looking at what Paul's talking about in verse 13. What does it mean? What does that mean to be ready to die? Paul says, I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. We heard it last time earlier in chapter 20. We're hearing it again that when Paul said these goodbyes along the way, there was weeping and there was grieving. There was pleading. Maybe even there was begging. Paul, stay here. Stay safe. Stay away from Jerusalem. We all know what's going to be there. It's not a secret. Paul says, it's all right. I'm ready for it. Now, I'm going to give you a bit of a spoiler if you don't know how his story ends. Paul was still several years from his death at this point. It's not in the Bible. We don't find it, but we have it from historical testimony that he didn't die in Jerusalem. He died in Rome. And yet when we get to Jerusalem, he's going to be imprisoned, and that imprisonment is going to go through the rest of his years. But I want us to focus on this statement. What does it mean to be ready to die, and specifically to die for the Lord Jesus Christ? Now, maybe you're wondering, well, you know, if a Christian says that, is that really okay? Is that really right? Can we really be so reckless to say that? I mean, we're pro-life, we're pro-health, pro-staying alive because God gives us life. Does that even give room for someone, even Paul, to talk like that? Can we seriously put our lives in jeopardy for the Lord? Well, Paul's readiness at the very least meant that he did not fear death, but I think it would go even so far as to say that he was looking forward to it. Again, you and I, we think about death, we think about the topic of dying, and it's something dark and morbid. It's something that we say, well, let's talk about it over here. Let's not let kids really hear about death. And yet Paul wanted to die. Why did he want that? Well, we've looked at it before, but let's go back again to Philippians 1. Paul wrote to the church there, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage, so that now as always Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I'm to go on living in the body, that will mean fruitful labor for me. But I desire to depart, to be with Christ, which is better by far, but it's more necessary for you that I remain in the body. And what Paul is saying there is if he continued to live, it's only because Christ is in him. It's only because Christ is sustaining him. It's only because Christ has work for him to do. If it's up to him, he'd rather die because dying means he gets to go to be with Jesus. There's a better life waiting for him. And Paul knew, or at least he believed, I think we can pretty concretely say that, he believed that he was going to be harmed. He was going to be killed. Persecution of some type was going to be his death. He was going to lose his life because of his faith in Jesus Christ and because he was not ashamed to hide that. I don't think we can minimize that part of his life. Yes, he went around and he had all these people who loved God, and he was the one who led them in that way through the Spirit. He had all these people who loved him and said they want him to be safe, and yet goodbye was hard, but the reception, the greeting of his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ on the other side would always be so much better. To leave the brokenness and the violence and the hatred of this life is always so much less to trade than the greatness of the joy and the peace and the perfection of the life that is to come. And again, that's not to say that we try to get ahead of ourselves, that we try to do something that puts us in a deadly, a fatal situation. But we can't forget the reality of what is to come. That there is something far greater. And so I think we can summarize what Paul committed himself to was being both ready and wanting to die if it was God's will. That is Paul's mindset. And yet, let's think about us today. Does that mean that all of us should pursue that? That we have the hymn Living for Jesus, but should we also have a hymn of saying that we want to die for Jesus? And our second point tries to answer that. Putting one's life in danger for the purpose of the kingdom is the calling of some Christians. Suffering is the calling of all Christians. Putting one's life in danger is the calling of some Christians. Suffering is the calling of all Christians. Throughout the series on Acts, we've heard the Holy Spirit from time to time. And what we're hearing lately is, I would almost say, a conflicting thing. And all the commentators talk about that. Because on the one hand, it seems like the Spirit was telling people, hey, tell Paul that he's going to suffer and warn him not to go there. And yet Paul on the other side is hearing the Spirit, and the Spirit's telling him, the Spirit's preparing him, the Spirit's reminding him, hey, you're going to go there. You need to be obedient to this. And by the way, there's harm ahead. And there are different ways to look at that. Well, is the Spirit conflicting with the Holy Spirit? Like, that doesn't work in our theology. But perhaps maybe what was going on is that indeed it was to encourage Paul. That Paul needed to know, hey, all these people, like, you don't just have God with you, but you have the love, you have the encouragement, you have the prayers of all these people giving you courage to go back to what we looked at a few weeks ago. As you go on, as long as you live. Because it does seem quite appropriate, it does seem biblically true to say that it was God's will that Paul would die as a martyr. And that might be difficult for us to take, that God's plan, God's purpose in his ministry was for him to suffer, was for him to die. And yet I think if we can accept that, just as the people in Caesarea did, just as the people who were traveling with Paul did, then we can understand that when a missionary is planning to go somewhere, or a missionary is preparing to go into that field, and they say, you know what, I believe that God is calling me to go somewhere where I may lose my life. I believe I'm called, and that may be my end. Well, if we can accept that it was God's will for Paul to be a martyr, then I think it helps us to understand that they're not crazy. That contemporary missionaries are not crazy. They're not necessarily being reckless to say, I want to go somewhere where I may be killed. And it's not necessarily wrong to say that God led them there. And yet we also have to remember that it isn't just missionaries that go into places. We have to remember that it's everyday Christians that live in hostile places. There are plenty of believers that are living in dangerous places where it is not acceptable to believe in God. And yet God keeps them there for the benefit of his kingdom. He keeps them there for the benefit of the mission. And so that's true, and yet that doesn't mean that all of us should make it our goal that we're going to pursue death, that we're going to pursue peril, because God calls all different people to specific kingdom tasks. In order to go and to share the gospel, you kind of need to be alive, usually. And so God needs live people to go into neighborhoods, to go to the ends of the world. And so that means that we might find ourselves enjoying life, enjoying material blessings from God when others are severely deprived of that. And that's something that's just part of life. And yet, we shouldn't allow our blessedness, our prosperity, to mean that we should escape all pain for the sake of being followers of Christ. I want to put before us two passages, not in their entirety, but getting the point. 2 Timothy 2, verses, or 3, 10 to 15, Paul writes, you know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecution, sufferings, and yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. As for you, continue in what you've learned and have become convinced of. The Holy Scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. That's Paul. Peter now, again, we heard Peter earlier in Acts. Peter shares in 1 Peter 4, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you're suffering, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. Those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good." There we have it. The message of Scripture saying that everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering as though something strange is going on, but rejoice that your participation is in the sufferings of Christ. Brothers and sisters, not one of us, I don't think, wants to suffer. Right? Even when I'm out on the lake, if the weather gets too cold, I don't really want to be out there, and that's a fairly minimal suffering. Whether it's a good cause or a reckless cause, that isn't our goal, and yet God's word tells us it's really not if you suffer, but it's when you suffer. When you suffer for Christ, know that God is with you. Know that you're following the road that Jesus walked, the road that Jesus most painfully, most perfectly, most obediently walked, if we are willing to suffer. And so that brings us to our final point. Are you ready? Again, I can't figure out how to drink water. Are you ready to die, no matter your age? Are you ready, brothers and sisters, for your family members? Be that your blood family, your relatives, or your family in Christ. Whether it's expectedly or suddenly and seemingly too soon. I'm not asking, are you ready that it's not going to hurt? I'm not saying, are you ready that you're not allowed to feel sorrow? Now, when death happens, things tend to change drastically. The person we love, they're not there anymore. We can't talk with them. We can't experience life with them. Death is a consequence of the fall. It is part of the curse of sin. This is not what God intended originally for us. But brothers and sisters, if you're in Christ, you have no reason whatsoever to fear death. Whether it happens as persecution, whether it happens due to an accident or recklessness or any other circumstance, at any age, you can be ready for it. Is it scary to think about what dying might be like as a process? I think so. Is it strange to kind of have this unknown thing about it? Well, I don't think it's strange. Right? Not one of us knows when we die, what's the next moment going to be like? Are we asleep? Are we conscious? Do we just wake up in front of Jesus? Do we wake up like all the jokes talk about at the pearly white gates with St. Peter waiting to talk to us there? What is that going to be like? We don't know. And yet there's comfort and there's assurances in the words of Scripture, the words that God has set before us, that he will be with us. That how eternity will go is God with us because of what Jesus has done. Pastor and Christian rapper Tripp Lee has a song called I'm Good, and I put up some of the lyrics, but I'll try to just explain them if you aren't into rap, which I don't think many of you are, but I think it's a great song. So in this song, I'm Good, he's talking about how he can hear trouble is coming for him and death is at his doorway. Fear says he'll perish, but that ain't what his Lord says. Tripp talks about how he's full of joy because he's drank the living water. He feels pain, but he can't be knocked down because he's in Jesus. In the chorus, he sings, he's good to go. He's ready to die whenever because there is nothing in this planet that satisfies his soul. He's living for tomorrow because today is out of control. And so you can take his money, you can give him pain, you can kill him, and he has that Philippians 1 mentality that to die is gain. But here's my favorite part in the last verse of the song. He says, death is just a doorway to take me to my faithful lover, The lover of my soul is with me. You can shake the brother, but you'll never knock me down or take me under. That, brothers and sisters, sums up really well what it means for any of us to be ready to die. To not be in fear of the finality that's often associated with death, and there is finality. Let's not act like that's not real. But death on this earth is not our final page. It's not our last breath. It is not our ultimate end. If we believe in Jesus Christ, we will not perish because we have eternal life. If you haven't believed yet, it's my prayer that you sense the Holy Spirit stirring faith in you. The God who's powerful enough to pull witch doctors out of that life to have them. We heard several weeks ago, I thought about this last night, how they threw tens of thousands of dollars of sorcery scrolls into a fire. And this man was throwing an equally precious, valuable amount of witchcraft tools into the fire as well. If you experience a stirring like that, if you experience a stirring that causes you to long for something more than the brokenness of this life, then talk to me, talk to someone that you may have that confidence potentially. That when that day comes, when that time comes, which none of us knows when it will, whether it's by way of persecution or accident or sickness, we are ready for that day. We do not fear what death brings because we know the one who gives us new life. Amen. Let's pray. Our God and Father, we give you thanks for the testimony of your word. We give you thanks for the boldness and the confidence that your servants like Paul expressed, that he was ready. That he was ready and willing to die and to experience any harm for you. Lord God, for many of us, it's true that we live a life that is comfortable, that is rich, as was shared earlier, beyond measure. That we are wealthy. And yet, Lord God, would you remind us, would you keep us in the understanding and in the faith that what we have in possessions, what we have in our bank accounts, what we have in comfort is not at all going to continue on with us in the life that is to come. Lord, may we be willing to lose all of it if it meant the greatness and the joy and the success of your kingdom. Lord, we pray for your servants who are going out into places and who are in places that are hostile to the faith. Lord, would you give them perseverance and refuge in you? And Lord God, help us to seek you, to uplift them in prayer, but also, Lord, to listen for your calling, wherever you are calling us to go and however you are calling us to serve. All this we pray in your son's name. Amen. For our song of response, we're going to sing I Surrender All, and we've chopped a few verses out so that we have time to fellowship a little bit with Eve and Gia. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 5, I think is what I said. Yeah. Verses 1, 2, and 5, let's stand to sing, I Surrender All.
Trust him in his presence.
prepackaged treats out in the fellowship hall. So if you have a quick question, feel free to ask him out there or to ask in the parking lot as we go out. But again, thank you guys so much for coming. I appreciate it.
All of that was without my mic. That's great. Oh, well. You heard me, so. Well, brothers and sisters, as we go from this place, go with the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. Amen. We close this morning with I Am Not My Own.